is beating, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. The empty cross, the empty grave, life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. You wear the victor's crown. You are my hope and my defender. You're my savior and my friend. By your grace I live and breathe to worship you. At the mention of your greatness, in your name I will bow down. In your presence fear is silent, for you wear the victor's crown. Let your glory fill this temple. Let your power overflow. By your grace I live and breathe to worship you.
Among the candlesticks. What's that mean? He walks among his people. He's alive and well. You know, how many times did he come down and just has church with us? So, hallelujah. He's not dead, but he is risen. He's alive. Can we put our hands together and say amen? Amen. You may be seated this morning. I want to welcome everyone here this morning. What a glorious day it is that we have. To be able to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I don't know about you, but I'm always excited about what God has done and what He wants to continue to do. But we do welcome everyone here. If this is your first time here inside the bulletin, we have a little tab there. If you could fill that out, drop it in the offering. when we take up the offering here in just a few minutes. And then on the back, there's prayer requests, praise reports. We believe here that God turns the prayer requests into praise reports. And so we want to continue to praise the Lord for all that He has done and all that He's wanting to continue to do. I want to commend the teens this morning. Leneva had decided to be able to bring the teens out at 7 o'clock this morning. And I believe just about every one of them showed up. But I was looking at a couple of them, and I think that I came up with a new title for my sermon today, The Walking Dead. But we thank the Lord. They did an awesome job, and I was just proud of every one of them, and just thank the Lord for that. And so in your bulletin, we have several announcements, and we do want to share that all of the little ones from 10 years old under, we're going to have a little resurrection egg hunt immediately following the service out here, the playground area. And so if they didn't bring a bag, we got a little bag for them, and so on and so forth. But it's a good day to celebrate. Can we say amen? And we just thank the Lord for what He's done and what He wants to continue to do. And so, again, I'm going to ask the ushers to come forth as we worship the Lord in the giving of our tithe and offering.
See my hands and look at my feet. It's okay if it's hard to believe. It's my time to go, but before I leave, go tell the world about me. I was dead, but now I live. I've gotta go now for a little while, but goodbye. There's much to do here before you leave. So go tell the world about me. I was dead, but now I live. I've gotta go now for a little while. But goodbye is not the end. Journey, the end of the road. My spirit is with you wherever you go. You have a purpose, and I have a plan. I'll make you this promise, I'll come back again. But until then, go.
What a fitting song. Goodbye is not the end to those who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And also, I think we have a birthday girl this morning. I heard that Nora turned 7 years old. So happy birthday, Nora. Amen. 7 years old. Also in the bulletin, you might have seen the summer camp that is starting to be registered. Please see Madison for that information. And we want to continue to pray for our preschool that is doing so well. And just thank the Lord for what God is doing, not only here, but through the preschool also. Well, again, I just want to thank you for coming and being here this morning. And it is our desire to be able to worship the risen Savior. It is so awesome to know that He's alive and well. That He is alive and well. And so we just thank the Lord. The question that I would like to ask you is, what does the cross mean to you? What does the cross mean to you personally? We can hear about it, talk about it, but what does the cross mean to you? And then what does the resurrection mean to you? And so this past week, we have been focusing upon what we call the Week of Passion, or a Holy Week, of all that God had done through His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, for humanity. And so to be able to remember, you know, what He has done. And so we thank God that today is kind of the climax as we, Lord, come to the end of what we call the Holy Week, talking about the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. If you were here last week, we had spoken about Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday, the day in which the Jewish holiday Passover was about, where they had to come and celebrate Passover. And it was a big occasion, and the city would be full of the Jews that would come to be able to celebrate Passover. And last week I went through Passover, and this past Wednesday night, Maureen did a wonderful job just going a little bit deeper into Passover, where they had to bring the lamb. Most of you recall the story, and where when the children of Israel was in bondage in Egypt, God had instituted this Passover to happen, because the last plague that God was going to bring upon Egypt was the death of the firstborn. So they were instructed to get a lamb, a yearly, if you will, the first year, a young lamb, and they were to make sure that it was without blemish. And see, we were reminded Wednesday night that that little lamb had to be brought into their house to be able to protect it, because it had to be without blemish. It was an important thing. And so they would probably get familiar with that little lamb. The kids, you know how kids get attached real quick to animals. But can you imagine what would happen as when it was time for the Passover lamb to be sacrificed, that they would just kill that little lamb? And I'm sure that the children are saying, "What? Why? What did the little lamb do wrong?" And they wouldn't understand. But that's what God had instituted back in those days. But they were to take that blood and put it over the doorpost and the lintel. And their family was to gather together inside that home. So when the death angel would come, they would see the blood applied. And the death angel would pass over. And so obviously, all of the Israelites that obeyed and did that, then there was no death. So the death angel passed over. But all the cry of death that happened in Egypt, all of the firstborn that was dead because they didn't have the blood of the lamb applied. So God had instituted Israel to partake of Passover all throughout the generations. But it all would foretell the climax of the Son of God, the Lamb of God, which would come to be able to take away not just Jewish sins, but the sin of the world. As John would identify Him as the Lamb of God, which would take away the sin of the world. So last week, we had was reminded about Passover, where the city was just roaring with excitement and praise, because during Passover, many knew that the Messiah was supposed to come, and many believed that the Messiah was Jesus Christ. He had touched many lives many, many lives Jesus had touched. And so now, Jesus has instructed his disciples to go get this donkey, and they went and got the donkey, and he was put upon that donkey, and he began to ride into the city. And when the people began to come and gather together, there was such a loud praise, enthusiastic praise, because why? The Messiah was here. And we find that, as I shared last week, that they would begin to shout, Hosanna, quoting Psalms 118, 25 through 26. Save us, we pray, O Lord. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest, as they laid down their garments and their palm branches, humbly submitting to their awaited king that was coming. Would you like to have been among that crowd? Could you imagine how loud it was? Can you imagine the people, you know, that was there? Exuberant praise that was happening. And so what a move of God, if you will, during that time. And so this was happening, and so they were celebrating Jesus. And because why? Because Jesus had touched their lives in some way. You know, and so it is so awesome for us to know that Jesus wants to touch your life and my life in some way. Amen. It isn't just about knowing the cross. You need to know why the cross. Amen. And what he has done for you and I. And so we find that here as we continue to look at what we had talked about last week, refreshing our memories, how they were just excited about the coming king. See, they wanted Jesus to come and overthrow the Roman government. They had tortured them and abused them, and they treated the Jewish people like dirt. So now here comes Jesus, the son of David, because David once was the mighty king. Amen. So they're crying out, son of David. And so they're exciting, and they're so exuberant, and their expectations are so high because finally the Messiah has come. But oh, how things had drastically changed in Jerusalem by Friday. Because they wake up to a whole different scenario. And so now these same people that were shouting Hosanna and praising him were in shock, confused, and they were mourning, angry, and frustrated at what they did to the Messiah. See, everybody didn't love Jesus. Matter of fact, the religious rulers of the day, they were jealous of him. Jesus had called them out on their hypocrisy. They really didn't care much about the people. All they cared about was their position. And even during Passover, it was a time for them to make big money. Because instead of them bringing their own lamb, no, we'll sell you one over here. And so when Jesus went into the temple and he turned over the money changers' table and he took a whip and he drove them out, they made, I mean, Jesus, you know, was righteous and angry, but they hated Jesus with the passion. He's got to die. So when they was looking for the opportunity, they found this opportunity through Judas, one of his disciples that would betray him with the kiss. They would arrest him. It would be done during the night. See, they was trying to conceal their dirty deeds because they didn't want to start an uproar. How many of you know there's a lot of dirty deals that's done behind the walls of this nation? But yet we find that it was all prophesied and it was all for a reason. And so they arrested him, and then they came up with this mock trial in the middle of the night. And so they had this mock trial, and then they brought forth false witnesses. And after that, they spit in his face. Can you imagine somebody spitting in your face? Much less Jesus. They spit in his face. They beat him profusely. Then they turned him over to a cruel Roman soldiers and who mocked him and poured out his beard. They continued to mock him by putting a purple robe on him and a crown of thorns and then beat it over his head and said, "Oh, hell, King of the Jews." It probably was the most torturous things that an individual could go through. Why God would pick this is amazing to me. All his amazing love. Can we say amen? But he endured all of this. And so, obviously, they brought him before Pilate. And Pilate says, "Listen, I see no fault in this man." But they begin to cry out, "Crucify him, crucify him." So the squeaky wheel gets the grease, the louder voices. So Pilate washes his hands of this and turns him over to their demands. And they take him out and they nail him upon a cross. They shamed him, humiliated him. The things that they did through hatred. You know, hatred is a terrible thing. And so we find that Jesus, even upon the cross, many of you have heard about the last seven sayings of Christ, but one of them was, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Because Jesus at any time could have said, "Father, it's enough." He could have, but he didn't. Jesus paid it all. Can we say amen? So see how fast, in just a few days, they was worshiping and they was praising. And they was glorifying God and life was great. And then all of a sudden, they've taken the Messiah. They have done this. So there was shock, confusion, frustration. You know, how many of you know that life can change just like that? Just like that. You ever been there? You're riding on the clouds. God is good. This is the day that the Lord has made. I mean, you're just, this is great. God, my God is an awesome God. And then all of a sudden, something comes into your life just like that. Could be a car accident. It could be a serious relationship problem. It could be the death of a loved one. Maybe a loss of a job or the strain of a relationship. But all of a sudden, maybe you went to the doctor and you got that bad health report. Just like that. And now you're saying, "God, why? God, why?" So these people that was celebrating last week, as we talked about Palm Sunday, I'm sure that they had a lot of questions. People say, "Well, you know, you're not supposed to question God, but you know, and we do, God, why? Why is this happening? How in the world, God, could you have allowed this to happen?" Have you ever said that? Yes. God, if you love me, why? And I've said why sounds a lot like whining, but why? So they was confused and they was frustrated. And they didn't understand the ways of God. See, we have such an advantage because we're on this side. I said, we're on this side of the cross. We're on this side of the resurrection. But yet, their lives are so typical of our lives today. And so we find that, obviously, we don't always know what God's doing, do we? They didn't know, but God was fulfilling prophecy. I said God was fulfilling prophecy. God knew exactly where they were at. God knew exactly what he was doing. Can we say amen? You know, so for 3 days, their followers were in confusion. And so asking, "Why, God? How can you possibly let this happen? He was the Messiah. God." How many of you have done this? The things that I thought that I believed, I'm now questioning. Because of what just happened. How many of you know the devil doesn't play fair? And so, I just ponder on this, that can you understand? Because we go through those seasons in our lives that we just don't understand. We don't understand. But yet in Isaiah 55:9 says, "For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." But at this time, they didn't know. Isaiah 53, "He is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrow and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. Everyone has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before the shears, silent. So he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who will declare his generation? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was stricken. And they made his grave with the wicked, but with the rich at his death, because he had done no violence, nor any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him." They didn't know Isaiah 53 like we today know Isaiah 53. How many of you know there's a lot of Jews in Israel that don't believe that Jesus was the Messiah? And this is the passage of Scripture that is always spoken to him. Who fits this passage? There's only one. I said there's only one. And so his ways are not our ways. His ways are much higher than our ways. And so how many of you know that God at that point was working not only for the Jew but all of humanity? That he is the one who was going to take upon your sin and my sin. He was the Lamb of God. Amen? When they nailed him upon that cross, you know, he was shamed that we may not be ashamed. He was rejected that we may be accepted. You know, the things that God did, how many of you know he died our death that we may not die for the penalty of our sin? Can we put our hands together and say amen and amen and amen? You know, and later on, Peter had wrote, "Knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver and gold from your aimless conduct received by traditions of your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. He indeed was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in this last days for you who through him believe in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God." So in reality, Jesus was the Messiah and he is the Messiah. But when he came, he was delivering them, but not from the Roman government. He was delivering them from the enemy that we all have in common, which is called sin. Our enemy is sin, and he was delivering us. He is our deliverer. Amen. Hosanna. Save us from our enemy. Amen. And you know what sin has done in your life and my life? It destroys our lives. It destroys families. It destroys communities, and it's destroying our nation. It's sin. And so Jesus came. He who knew no sin became sin, that the righteousness of God might come upon us. And so he was saving us and delivering us from our enemy. No longer do we have to be a slave to sin. How many of you are glad that you've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb today? Can we say amen? Not only has he forgiven me, but I don't have to be a slave to sin. When that sin calls Joe, Joe don't have to answer anymore, because I can send Jesus to the door and say, in the name of the Lord, I resist you, devil. Can we say amen? And so now, you know, Jesus is the one who gives freedom from sin. You know, and so that freedom is so incredible. But it isn't something that just happens out here. It's something that happens in here. Can we say amen? Because Jesus came not only to change, not only to cleanse our hearts, but to change our hearts. Can we say amen? Oh, the love of God that was displayed upon the cross. And so Jesus had spoken to his disciples many times about his coming death, but they didn't understand. Many times. Jesus had said, most assuredly I say unto you, unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much grain. Unless the kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies. What is he talking about? You know, he says, and if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all people to myself. So Jesus would get his disciples together and say quotes and things like this, but they did not understand. Let me ask you something. Do you read the Bible? Sometimes we don't understand. But yet, how many of you know he who wrote the scriptures will give us understanding? There's so much that we don't understand. When we're going through those dark days and difficult times, you know, I encourage you to get in this word and listen to what the Holy Spirit says to you, because he's the one that wrote the book through men. Can we say amen? Amen. And they didn't understand what Jesus was saying. And sometimes when we go through seasons in our lives, we don't always understand. But I'm telling you what, God gives us his word, and we can stand upon that word. Can we say amen and hallelujah? And so God will speak to you sometimes. He'll speak to you, but sometimes you might not understand. Maybe we're not paying attention and he's speaking. But I'm telling you what, the Lord is so loving and so kind that he's always trying to draw people. He is. He's trying to give us fresh and new revelation about who he is and who we can be in him. Are you with me this morning? Amen. And so we find that those 3 days had to be some very challenging days for the people and the disciple that loved Jesus. Can we say amen? But then on the third day, I said on the third day, on the third day, you know, they went to the grave and found that the stone was rolled away. Hallelujah. You know, on that resurrected morning, and if you want to, you can turn to Matthew 28. It's in all of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John. But Matthew 28 shares the story, you know, and each Gospel shares a little bit more light of what happened that morning. And so the women, the Bible talks about Mary Magdalene. She was a individual that was particularly pointed out in the gospel because she had a love for Jesus. And one of the reasons she loved him, because the Bible says that he had cast out 7 demons from her. You ever dated anybody that had 7 demons? No, don't answer that. But they was going to the tomb. They was coming to take spices, and they was going to minister to a dead body. They was probably come. They probably had plenty of napkins because they was going to mourn. But yet when they got there, the stone was rolled away, not to let Jesus out, but to let them in. They encountered an angel, and the angel says, "Why are you here looking for the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen. He is not here. He is risen." See how life is like a roller coaster? They didn't understand what God was doing, but all of a sudden, I like those suddenlies. How about you? You like those suddenlies? Suddenly, what? What I thought was happening really It's not really happening. How many of you know sometimes we get ourselves in a frizzy worrying about, oh my gosh, what about this? What about this? You know, worry, worry, worry. But yet they came and they found that angel had given a message. Now, I didn't write this, but some people said that the reason Jesus chose women because he wanted the message to get told quickly. Hey, they was the first preachers, amen? And how many of you know, I've heard a long time, you know, what's the fastest form of communication? Yeah. Telegraph, telephone, telewoman, yeah, absolutely. But look how things change so quickly. Things change so quickly. And that's our God, isn't it? Our God. You may not understand what I'm doing, but I'm working. And I've got a plan for your life. And so, you know, they left and they came with sadness, but they left with gladness. How many of you know that's what the presence of God does? You know, Mary Magdalene, and I like to mention her every Easter Sunday, because Mary Magdalene, though the other women left, she stuck around for a while. She was like, I don't know if I buy this story. But she tarried. Yes. I said she tarried. The Bible talks about those who diligently seek him. And Mary Magdalene was one that was just saying, where are you? And he actually appeared to Mary that morning. The one who probably the city despised because of her reputation, and whom was cast out 7 demons, he reveals himself. And when Jesus reveals himself and she finally recognizes him, what does she do? Grabs a hold of him. Jesus! Grabs a hold of him to the point he said, you got to let me go. Kind of like when Rhonda grabs you. You know, like. Love you, Rhonda. But see, you're talking about your first love. That was her first love. How many of you know Jesus should be your first love? See, every other relationship is temporary. Our relationship with him is eternal. Can we say amen? So we find that he revealed himself to her. And then after that, we read about the two that he communed with on the road of Emmaus. Later that evening, he met with his 10 disciples locked in a room, afraid. A week later, he showed himself to doubting Thomas. And then we find that, you know, the news was starting to spread quickly throughout the city. Jesus is not dead, he's alive. Jesus is not dead, he's alive. And it began to spread. I said it began to spread. You know, go and tell, go and tell. And so we find that Paul even said in 1 Corinthians 15:6, for I delivered to you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scripture, and that he was buried, and that he rose again on the third day according to the scriptures, and he was seen by Cephas, which is Peter, then by the 12, and after that he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, and of whom the greater part remain to the present. He was talking about back at that time, but some has fallen asleep. After that, he was seen by James and all of the apostles. And then last, he was seen also by me as one born out of due time. This was showing himself alive and well. I'm alive. How many of you know he wants us to believe that he's alive and well? And we find that they touched his body. Thomas, what did Thomas say? Hey, I'm not going to believe unless I touch his body. And he appeared to Thomas. Touch me. He ate with them. He spent time with them that they may be fully persuaded that he wasn't dead, that he was alive. Hallelujah. And then the Bible tells us that Jesus, you know, had continued to fulfill the scriptures and the things that God had already foreordained. When you look at Matthew 27:51, it says, "Then behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth quaked, and the rocks were split, and the graves were opened." And look at this. "And many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised, and coming out of their graves after his resurrection, and they went into the holy city and appeared to many." And some were saying, "Who are these?" Well, have you ever heard of Noah? You ever heard of David? You ever heard of all of the Old Testament saints? That they weren't in a literal hell. They were in soul, or Hades as it is translated in the Bible. And many believe that it was the center of the earth. If you're ever familiar with the story of Abraham and the rich man and the other man that died, and there was a great gulf between the two. Have you ever read that parable? So Jesus, the Bible talks about in, and well, let me back up a little bit. Acts 2:25 says, "For David says concerning him, I foresaw the Lord always before my face, for he is at my right hand, that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart rejoiced and my tongue was glad. Before my flesh also will rest in hope. For you will not leave my soul in Hades, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption." So David was speaking prophetically, and guess what? When Jesus died, he went down to set the captives free. Let me tell you what the Bible says. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one will come before the Father but by him. So he ascended to be able to deliver the captives. Pastor Joe, is that real? 1 Peter 3:18. "For Christ also offered once for sin, and just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, by whom also he went and preached to the spirits in prison." And so Jesus, can you imagine when Jesus came down? Can you imagine the celebration that took place? And the Bible says that when Jesus come alive, these Old Testament saints was in the street. You're talking about a ghost story now. But yet, God is the one who brings dead things back to life. I said, God is the one who brings dead things back to life. And what a celebration that was. And the Bible tells us that, you know, Jesus still sets captives free today. Can we say amen and amen? You know, and then we find that in John 20:17, as I just shared, Mary Magdalene was holding on to him. And it says, he said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God." There was one more triumphal entry that he had to do. Guess what? Jesus was sent on a mission from the Father. Amen. How many of you believe he was the first missionary? You know, and he said, "Son, I want you to go down and redeem my people." You know, and Jesus came. He was born in a virgin. Amen. Virgin Mary. Amen. He fulfilled the purposes in which God had given to him. But now the day had come that, "Father, my work is finished." Upon the cross, he said, "It is finished." Can you imagine when he came back to heaven? Can you imagine how heaven was in an uproar and they were all praising him, glorifying his name? I'm telling you what, he had the scars on his body to be able to prove that he was the Lamb of God. And when you read in the book of Revelation, it says, "Holy, holy, holy, the one who was and is and the is to come." Can you imagine the praise and the adoration that went on in heaven? You know, and how many of you believe it's still going on today? Can we say amen and amen and amen? Amen. Psalms 24:7, lift up your heads, all ye gates, and be lifted up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, all you gates. Lift up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. How many of you believe that he is still the King of glory, and he is the resurrected Lord today? John saw him in Revelation in 1:14, and his head, the head and the hairs were white as wool, and his, and white as snow, and his eyes were like a flame of fire, and his feet were like fine brass, as it was refined in a furnace, and his voice was the sound of many waters. And he had in his right hand 7 stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword. And his countenance was like the sun shining in his strength. And when I saw him, I fell down on my feet like as dead. But he laid his right hand upon me, saying to me, do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am he who lives, was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. I have the keys of Hades and of death. Can we put our hands together and say amen and amen and amen? It's a quite different picture of a man crucified upon the cross to where he is today. Can we say amen? He is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. And we just thank the Lord that God was the one who sent his son to redeem us. And now the Bible says he's at the right hand of the Father making intercession for us. Even right now, as you're sitting in your seat, how many of you believe the Holy Spirit is speaking to every one of you? He's speaking to every one of us, making intercession. Will you come? Will you believe? But you know, the greatest enemy, you know, that he delivered us from was sin. But the last enemy that mankind has to face is death. Death. How many of you are glad that Jesus overcome death? Amen. Yes. Death. Amen. You know, 1 Corinthians 15:20 says, but now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of all of those who have fallen asleep. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, but all in Christ shall all be made alive. But each one in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterwards those who are Christ at his coming. Then comes the end, and he will deliver the kingdom of God to the Father when he puts an end to all rule and all authority and power. For he must reign till he has put all enemy under his feet. The last enemy that will be destroyed is death. For he has put all things under his feet, but when he says all things are put under him, it is evident that he who put all things under him is accepted. It is so awesome today that we don't have to fear death. Not only are we saved, born again, delivered us from sin, but think about it. We don't have to fear death anymore. What a glorious gift that he has given us. That you don't have to fear death. He has overcome death. Jesus said, whosoever believeth in me shall never see death. You know what happens when we take our last breath here? We just take a new breath in heaven in eternity. How many of you believe that he is alive and well? How many of you believe John 14 where he said, I go away and prepare a place for you? He said, if I go away and prepare a place, then I'm going to come again. In my Father's house are. Who built these mansions? You know, thank God for Billy and all the builders. But let me tell you what. You and I are going to get a mansion built by the hands of God. And so, think about it. We don't have to be afraid. We don't have to be afraid of death anymore. You know, it's amazing, you know, how fear comes upon us. And people don't want to die. I don't want to die, but yet it is amazing what people are doing to stay alive. How many of you know that there's certain people that when they got the money and they have their bodies frozen That in the future they'll figure out a way how to bring them back to life. Honey, let me tell you what, Jesus already take care of that. You know, we don't have to fear death. I want that to sink in. Because, you know, when we know the Lord Jesus Christ and we have that confidence, we know because He paved the road to heaven. Can we say amen? You know, the money that people spend, I was looking up a couple of things. In 2021, medical costs for those in the U.S. was estimated as $378 billion. It was also estimated that healthcare costs was $4.3 trillion. In 21 to 22, estimated that plastic cosmetic procedures costs went from $9 billion to $16.7 billion in 1 year. As a man said that his wife wanted plastic surgery. It's going to cost $10,000. So he said, okay, honey, gave her the $10,000. Well, she left and never came back. He said, now I'm out of $10,000 and I don't even know who to look for. The money that we're spending. How many of you know not only did Jesus provide a place that we're going to live, but we're going to have a glorified body? How many of you are looking forward to that glorified body? Hallelujah. See, day by day, this outer man is perishing. But the Bible says also the inner man should be renewed day by day. Amen? We spend all of this money, all of this stuff. You know, I want to live longer. And it's okay. I think we need to eat healthy. Can we say amen? Don't you think we need to have the correct diets and do what? Amen. If we'll do our part, God will do His part. But one of the things about it is that we know that the Bible says that not only do we not have to fear death, but we're going to have a glorified body. It does not yet appear what we shall be, but we shall be like Him. You know, Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15:54, so when this corruption has put on incorruption and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the triumph through Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Can we put our hands together? Hallelujah. Guess what? In heaven, no more sickness, no more diseases. Can we say amen? No more hospitals, no more health care. Amen? There ain't no more funerals in heaven. How many of you know not only has He given us a mansion, but He's provided, you know, food from the tree of life. Can we say amen? You know, Paul has said this, eye has not seen nor ear heard the things that God has prepared for His people. Can we put our hands together and say amen? You know, I tell you what, we celebrate a lot of things, but we need to be celebrating today what God has done for us through the Lord Jesus Christ. Can we say amen and amen and amen and amen and amen and amen? I'm going to ask the praise team to come. Jesus paid it all. You don't have to fear death. You don't have to fear because Jesus made a way. And it is so awesome that we can think about heaven. How many of you have given it much thought? Well, Pastor Joe, what are we going to do in heaven? What are we going to do in heaven? I would dare to believe that most of you haven't even given it much thought. But see, in this life, it's very temporary. But let me ask you a question. What do you think you're going to be doing 5,000 years from now? What do you think you're going to be doing in 10,000 years? See, time is not an element in heaven. What does Peter say? A year is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years like a day, right? Is that right? But eye hasn't seen nor ear heard the things that God has prepared for His people. So this morning, we're gonna ask everyone in this room, is your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? It's the most important decision that you're ever going to make. It's not hope so or maybe so or I think so. No, no, no. You need to have a hope, no-so faith. Can we say amen? Not a hope so. Pastor Joe, I hope I make it. I've done the best that I could do. Well, let me tell you, if that's your theology, your best is never going to be good enough. You must be born again. Jesus paid it all. And so this morning, if you are here and you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, He is calling to you. What a glorious day it was, but yet, what about you? Is it a glorious day for you? Today we're celebrating. Those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life, we're celebrating all around the world. We're celebrating. And if you're here today and you don't know Him, we want you to join the party. We want you to be there. We want to look. I don't know about you, but my grandma is gone. My grandma's, my mom, my dad. I have several that's there. They're rejoicing today. I don't know what they've been doing, but I'm sure they're celebrating. And we want everyone to be able to join the party. How many of you believe that Jesus died, that everyone would be there? So I'm going to ask you to bow your head this morning. Close your eyes. Just bow your head. No looking around. I'm just going to ask you a simple question. Are you sure that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life? Have you asked Jesus to come into your life? Have you asked Him to transform your life? If you have not, I'm simply going to ask you, just lift up your hand and say, I need salvation. I need, Pastor Joe, there's sin in my life and I need to repent of my sin. How many of you know, He said if you will confess your sin, He is faithful and just to forgive you and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. Well, I take it that everybody in this room has your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and I pray that that's true. Hallelujah. Because we want everybody to go. We don't know when Jesus is going to come back. We don't know when that accident is going to happen. But we want to make sure that you know the Lord Jesus Christ. That you're ready. That you have that confidence. Father, this morning as we bow our heads before You, we humbly thank You for the blood and Your body. We thank You, God, for the atonement that You made that we may have salvation. Lord, You said if we would confess with our mouth and believe in our heart that God has raised You from the dead, Jesus, that we shall be saved. And God, thank You for every person in this room who says, yes, I've made that decision. But Lord, if there's one here today who has hesitated, and Lord, for whatever reason they wouldn't lift up their hands, I pray, Lord, don't let them alone. Continue to speak to their hearts. Continue to minister to them that they may understand You're a wonderful Savior that died for them. You love them that much. And God, that they can have that confidence. Lord, if they die today, Lord, that they're going to be rejoicing with You for all eternity. So, Father, I pray that You would just breathe upon them. And I pray that You would just breathe upon each and every one. And God, today, we just continue to thank You for what You've done. And Lord, those, all of us here that are born again, Lord, we just thank You. As we look back at what You have done and what You have told us to do, and Father, that You will be glorified in our hearts and in our lives, Lord, that we will glorify Your name through these earthen temples. Until You, Lord, call us home, Lord, let us be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in Your work, that Your purposes will be fulfilled. And we love You, Jesus. This morning,